Okay, well, thanks, first of all, for the opportunity to talk with you in this interview. It's a big question. I remember once being asked that question, given the fact that my profession is an art educator, and I said that my first definition of myself was as an artist, and this has been since I was about 5 years old, and that's because I grew up in a home where my father was a professional artist. There was an art studio in the home, and I was using arts materials since I was five, and even as a teacher, even as a professor, I see myself first as an artist. But that's a part of the response I would give. The other part maybe is a little bit more complicated, because it's sometimes a little bit too easy to define or attempt to define who one is or what one is believed to be socially. And I think that I spend a lot of time undefining myself, right? Contesting definitions. Because part of my argument is that anyone, since identity is a moving target, it's a lot more than people expect them to be. Right? One of the problems with, one of the issues that we continue to deal with socially is the, especially in the United States, is the idea of stereotypes. And what a stereotype is, essentially, is a definition that is that has too little information. Right? So when you have too little information about someone, it's easy to draw a cartoon and say that's who that person is. And I believe in busting some of those outlines. So the definition, so you know, so that's the long route of saying how I define myself or what I see my identity to be. I do see it as something that is a moving target. And as I move from situation to situation, for instance, right now, I see myself as a collaborator, right? As I come here to your wonderful country, and I'm attempting to figure out ways to work together creatively with people I'm just beginning to know. So I see myself as a collaborator, but that definition can change as we go forward.
Okay. Mm-hmm. It's a good question to address for a lot of different reasons. Because when you say that, it immediately brings to mind these questions of identity. Mm-hmm. And as I negotiate identity, I say that identity is defined from within, but also defined from without. So as Dr. Rowling mentions, sometimes we have to contest identities, but I think it also means that in some cases, we have to abandon identities depending on which aspects of our identities are we willing to take responsibility for. Someone asked me recently, am I Muslim? And I am Muslim as I define it within. But as I think about taking responsibility for what that means to different people, I don't know if that's a conversation that I'm willing to start at this point. And the same thing applies to race. And there are some things we can accept and take for granted. I'm a father. Many people know what that means, you know. But to say, to take responsibility for assumptions and stereotypes and bias and representations, sometimes it depends on the depth of the relationship. So when you say, how do I define myself? It's really a question of, it's a conversation starter, mm-hmm. right? So that is the impetus for a much bigger exchange. So to really answer that, we'd have to go to lunch again. Right? But the short answer would be a question of combing through and recycling and contesting all of those spaces. If you are a father and I'm a father, I think we can probably come to some mutual ground mm-hmm. about what it means to love and take care of our children mm-hmm. and to receive love. But for you to be Brazilian and me to be American, for example, is an interesting area that must be negotiated, contested, and renegotiated as we converse. So the answer is...
So I was listening to my colleague, Dr. Bey, description, and I just wanted to add, it caused me to understand or caused me to reflect a bit more. Oftentimes when I think about identity, I think about it in terms of multiples, right? So I am, depending on my situation, depending on my context, depending on who I'm talking to, depending on what group I have entered into, right? And how they define themselves. Part of the negotiation of identity, part of the reconstruction process is it can be daily. It can be at the moment, right? So that my identity today may be very different than the way I identify myself tomorrow. Might be very different depending on what group I am interacting with conversing with, having discourse with. So at any given time, I'm multiples, right? And I think that, I know that might be overly philosophical, but for me, it's a present reality. I do not see myself as one profession or as one role in life. I see myself juggling and moving from space to space, right?
I'm sitting next to my colleague, but I'm soon to quote him. And it was something that Dr. Rowling James published a few years ago, and I think it's definitely pertinent. But he referred to identity as interpsychological detritus.
Detritus, yeah.
And cultural debris.
Yeah.
And I think that if you understand it, I don't know how it translates into Portuguese. But both of those are decomposed matter. Mm-hmm. But decomposed matter that could be used to fertilize something new. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's a very pertinent and generative metaphor to think that, you know, so the soil, we have topsoil, and it's all these things that break down from nothing. Mm-hmm. But then something emerges from it. Mm-hmm. And I think it's very powerful to think that, yes, you know, you are a black man, or you are a Muslim, or you are the son of an iron worker, or the son of an artist. But all these things are, as they're renegotiated, mm-hmm. you know, they're decomposers, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. There's the sun. I mean, these external elements, mm-hmm. there's perception and bias and mm-hmm. assumption and the imposition of other cultural, political, social ideas mm-hmm. that essentially break down those notions of self and other. Mm-hmm. But then they become regenerative,
yeah.
and they birth new knowledge. Mm-hmm. So detritus and debris mm-hmm. are rich in nutrients, mm-hmm. despite not appearing to be something that is immediately nourishing, mm-hmm. at least not for our consumption. Mm-hmm.
Well, my response, that joyful response I just had, is an indication that this has been a wonderful trip for several different reasons. First of all, my gratitude to USP and to your institution and to you, Professor Matuk and Professor Aranha, for your hospitality. And not only of yourselves and your colleagues, but also of your students. It's been more than we expected, actually, even. And we expected a lot in terms of what we wanted to bring to the table, but you have provided such rich resources and such warm hospitality that Dr. Bey and I have been talking about it since we arrived. So this is my first time in South America, my first time in Brazil, and my first time learning elements of the Portuguese language. So it's been definitely a first time exercise, but we believe it'll be the first of, we hope to be the first of a number of times in the future. As I hopefully we represent our university, Syracuse University, here in your wonderful nation.
Muito obrigado, is the first thing I would like to say. as it pertains to my my response to coming to Brazil. I guess probably the more appropriate question to address is how do I respond to coming to University of São Paulo, because we've yet to see much of the country. We've certainly got to see the museum and our hopeful or potential collaborators in the Department of Aesthetics and Art History. Is that correct? And when I discovered that Dr. Rowling was coming here, I was very eager to connect and to gain support to come along with him, to be an extra pair of eyes and ears to see what potential this exchange could hold for us in our research endeavors and also in our teaching endeavors and our hope for eventual exchange. And I am very impressed as well about the collaborative model that you all have worked out that is very much interdisciplinary and very much aligned with Dr. Rowling and I's hopes for rethinking art education at Syracuse University. So thank you very much for the opportunity to be amongst you.
Well, just thinking about the question, I had an opportunity to sort of think about some of these questions in advance. And for that one, I would say that I don't necessarily think that it's a new methodology. I think it's new conversation about something that the producers of art might be very familiar with natively in terms of the way we go about conceiving and creating new knowledge, right? New ways of knowing. It certainly, arts-based research as a paradigm, which I consider to be something that's separate from the qualitative research paradigm, from the quantitative research paradigm, even though I think that there are overlaps. But the one thing, being based in arts practices, in arts knowledge, it certainly privileges empirical ways of knowing, interpretive ways of knowing, interrogative or questioning ways or approaches, and the allows you to ask, I believe, questions that are different than the questions that scientific research lends itself to. And going back to that notion of ways of knowing, arts-based research, I think, allows for the proliferation of new methodologies that build upon prior methodologies. And something that I think I've talked about already, and hopefully I will talk about a little bit more at the when I speak at the Brazilian Museum, tomorrow. So I think that it's both new and old, as a way of saying it. So, one of the things I have pointed out is that science does certain things very, very well, right? And I've never made the contention that arts-based research is meant to replace scientific research in a hierarchy. I think that science and the arts, and as ways of knowing, as ways of understanding the world, as ways of creating new knowledge, are twin peaks in human cognition. And one of the difficulties in the scientific era has been a devaluation of something that I think human beings have been doing for millennia in terms of how we understand the world and make sense of the world and signify the human experience, right? So the other thing that I would say is that I mentioned this a little bit before in terms of the questions that scientists is good at, right? Questions that have to do with proving certainties, questions that have to do with proving whether a claim is true or false. There's certain kinds of questions that you can get at through the sciences, but it's difficult unless if you're talking about creating models of knowledge that are other than statistically based or mathematically based models, then you begin to run into a problem with the sciences. So if you have, and then one of the things I've said is that science does a good job of capturing still frames, snapshots of certain bits of data, and developing meaning from that. But that one of the things that the arts do well, and arts-based models of knowledge do well, is capture moving images, moving pictures, as we interact with the world and phenomena and our relationships with other beings and other and with society. So that there is a, I think that there are in contrasting them, I think that the key is to understand that both have utility, right? And one shouldn't be valued over the other. And that's probably the best way of going about saying a response.
Right, complementing this, why you got so interested in this issue? How did you get started? Like, what caught your attention?
Well, for two reasons. One is that I have a mentor in the field of art education. I'm the chair of art education at Syracuse University, and I've been, I did my doctoral work at Teachers College at Columbia University. There's where I encountered a gentleman named Graham Sullivan. Graham Sullivan is from Australia. He was just coming to the United States at the time. He was just coming to Teachers College at the time. And he is an arts practitioner and an artist, and an art educator and a researcher. And he wore all three of those hats very, very well. And recently, well, actually, his first edition of a book called Arts Practice as Research was, I think, in 2005, looking specifically at visual arts as an inquiry model. It's now in its second edition. I think was pretty, came out in 2010. And so we've had a lot of conversations about the arts and arts practices as a foundation for research. And I feel like I, in writing my new textbook, which is an arts-based research primer, which will be published by Peter Lang, publishing by the end of 2012 or beginning of 2013. I feel like I'm carrying the ball a step further in terms of not just talking about the visual arts as a research model, but other arts practices. And my own dissertation was an exercise in an arts-based research. So the questions that I was able to ask and my approach to answering that question employed arts-based research, narrative research, poetry, visual imagery, my own works of art, found imagery and visual culture, and it just it was what was necessary for me to answer my question. So this has been with me for quite some time in terms I'll say the last thing is that my very first research articles were also exercises, published research articles were exercises in arts-based research. And I think it's been in and out of my research interest ever since I started out of the gate. So that probably answers the question.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, I had a dissertation. My dissertation title was "Unnaming the Story: The Post-Structuralist Repositioning of African American Identity in Western Visual Culture," and but it was daunting in terms of how I was going to answer the questions that I was interested in. I won't take the time to go into them here, but the point was that I knew that I needed a methodology, and for a while I thought I was writing history, I thought I needed historical methodology, and I found out that that wasn't the case. Mm. At a certain point, I began to look at post-structuralism as methodology, and that wasn't quite the case. That wasn't what I needed. Ultimately, what I needed was a methodology that would emerge from the processing of my data, and from the processing of, and I would say that my dissertation, while arts-based, it did draw upon some very specific methodologies that pre-existed, such as autoethnography, critical race studies, performance studies. But my colleague Dr. Bey was talking about, into psychological detritus and cultural debris, something that actually was a quote from my dissertation, I believe. But out of that messiness, right, of trying to figure things out and trying to figure out how to answer the questions that I was interested in, I developed a new methodology. And at the time, I called it visual culture archaeology, drawing upon Foucault, drawing upon ideas about visual culture. And it served my purposes and got me to an outcome, which was a plateau. And from that point on, it was something that I could then build upon, right? It wasn't a single outcome, it was a place where I could pause and then build upon again, which is very similar to what we do in the art studio. We gather materials, we develop possible outcomes, possibilities, we find a place where we make it feel we're ready to exhibit the work, and then we re-engage, right, and go back into it again and take it to the next place, right? So. Because it goes back to your question about arts production, right, and how this can relate now and inform arts production. And ultimately, as we know as artists, that the arts are a deeply reflexive process. There's a quote that I take and use often in terms of the idea of researchers, each man, each woman being their own methodologist. We are central to the act of research. We're conduits for the collection of data, for the interpretation of data, for the which is information, right? We think about science, and sometimes the models and language and vocabulary of science is so weighty that we forget that science is just a species of research. The arts are another species of research. We tend to make the mistake of thinking that science is research, and that's not accurate. We've been using humanity has been using multiple modes for quite some time. And I want to get at two things. First, that multiplicity, right? So we know that there are different definitions of art and why people practice art. And this is very broad, and we know that there are overlaps, but in general, there are those who think about making art as the making of beautiful forms or objects in the world, and a mastery of certain techniques for manipulating those objects and materials that form those objects. And that's what art is, and the genesis of their grasp of materials in the world, and phenomena in the world. We know that there are other artists who look at arts as a form of information, right? Informing of self, of expression, of cultural symbols. We know that others look at the arts as a transformative force, contesting the status quo, normalized beliefs, and trying to turn things upside down, shake things up so that we can make a better world for ourselves. So there are a lot of different ways that people approach producing art, and we need to remember that, right? But that all goes to what I think is a primary motivation for art education, going back to what Dr. Bey was saying. For me, I see it as a matter of social justice. And why would I say that? It's largely because I see the arts as an opportunity to develop a particular kind of creative agency, one where you can come, you can decode what's presented to you in the world and recode it. And whether that means changing or proliferating new identities or new ideas or new subjects or new methodologies, it's the discovery of the new which is, I think, the motivating factor for most anyone who's using arts-based means of production. But just the same way, it's also about as varied as it possibly can get, which is why, for me, it becomes an opportunity to develop new methodologies and not to stay with what has been created or in the past.
Two questions, or maybe even relate what Dr. Rowling was just talking about, which involves the self. Mm-hmm. And I think the self in that way, and problematizing the self in relationship to data or in relationship to the data collection process, mm-hmm. is integral to arts-based practices. Mm-hmm. So as I said yesterday, who am I, why am I, why do I do this, mm-hmm. Is a significant question. So the question about arts-based research as it relates to art production, mm-hmm. is that's what artists do. And I think that the other question relates very well to, as it pertains to, as arts-based research compares or pertains to a more rooted scientific forms of research, is the value of truth, so to speak, versus the value of discovery. Mm-hmm. So discovery and valuing discovery is privileging, in many regards, the quest. And the quest as it pertains to individuals, not as it pertains to how it moves humanity forward. Mm-hmm. So what about me? What about me in relationship to the discoveries that I make as an individual? And how do those discoveries relate to me? As it also relates to the battle for art education. And I will say that it is, in the United States, it's a battle. Because, and this is why I also think that the discourse of arts-based research is so critical to how we as a society are framing how we see education, mm-hmm. is that there are people who think that it is a dispensable aspect of our curriculum and our being, that we don't need to support art. So as it pertains to that, it's ironic because many students learn to perform throughout their education. They don't learn to ask important questions. Mm-hmm. They don't always learn how to critique themselves and themselves in relationship to the world. But that process is central to the production of artists, mm-hmm. art and artists. And it's really ironic because we have these major corporations in the U.S. and they get to the top of the line and start identifying attributes for job candidates. Mm-hmm. And the attributes that they identify are about divergent thinkers and critical thinkers and risk takers. And in many cases, not as many as I would like, they're recognizing the value of artists. And I've actually worked as a consultant to work with corporate boards, and they envy artists. And they envy artists because they've spent their lives trying to conform, mm-hmm. and not taking risks and following some measure of success that does not allow for the kind of organic problem solving that is central to the practice of artists. So as it pertains to me and my production as an artist and its relationship to research, it gives me a different kind of space to ask a different kind of question. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, when we talked, Dr. Rowling and I talked last night about activities that put out various kinds of feelers. Mm-hmm. And I said, everything seems so serendipitous. No, it's not that everything always seems so serendipitous. It's just that the way that we work sends out so much. It's like, wow, that connects to the curator. That connects to the historian. That connects to this epistemology. It's just that the work that we do is so generative and sometimes so holistic that it pulls in so many other disciplines. You know, just listening to everyone talk on the faculty, it's like, wow, I can co-author a piece with her. I can collaborate with him. And I think that it's because we are keeping this methodology central to, if nothing else, our philosophy. As it pertains to arts-based research, there are a couple of other points that I wanted to mention. As it pertains to where we are currently and also historically, first of all, I don't think by and large, and I can only speak for the U.S., that artists consider themselves researchers in the United States, by and large. It's a sweeping kind of generalization, but in terms of how people frame and talk about their practices and write about their practices and artist statements, I don't think many artists think of themselves as such. And I also want to add that art education has, by and large, been reframed as an academic field, which essentially means that there's a PhD in art education that over the last 60 years has been primarily defined through writing and research and not through making. So if we were to look at some of the older programs in the United States in the 40s and 50s, artists who are, and I say artists who are pursuing PhDs, were painting murals and writing about the pedagogical implications of their making, which is a very different process than some of the forms of qualitative research that have since taken precedent. So in a certain degree, we're kind of evolving into something that we once were. And it's perhaps because I feel like the field had felt in some way like it had something to prove. You know, and what are we in relationship to other qualitative forms of social research? And what are we in relationship to other kinds of curricular or pedagogical research? So I feel like we in some way had to earn our right to be heard. I talked yesterday about the demystification of art making and artists, where I think that many of us, or I definitely feel that I'm continually trying to convince students, colleagues, other professionals that it's not magic, that something is happening as it relates to our cognitive development, our social interactions, and the cultural and political relevance of our production. So the point is, it's not something we whip out a wand and make to be fetishized and to be mystified, but there are actual legitimate quests and methods associated with our productions.
One of the largest or more important reasons as to why I'm writing this introductory textbook at this time is to help build a vocabulary for us to talk about things that we perhaps have already been doing as practitioners. As I said before, the language of the sciences is a strong language. It's weighty, and it and we tend to think once again about research. We think about research, and we think about research as science, as opposed to what we already do. Right. So yes, artists oftentimes don't think of themselves as researchers, but that's because a vocabulary is dominated by another paradigm. Right. So my hope with the primer, the introductory textbook, is to help develop our language for what we already do and what we can continue to do and continue to proliferate, and also to develop to help create an architecture so that it'll be more easy to see where we have been practicing, where our practices are organized, and because you know the arts can be self-organizing. And so then after the fact, you have to sort of see what has been wrought, what has been built, what has been constructed. And it doesn't mean that it freezes. It just means that the architecture is flexible enough to continue to build outward, to continue to add on to maybe reconfigure, right? But to sort of give a sense of where we have been and what we are already doing as practitioners, and then where we can go from here. Right?
I also wanted to add, as it pertains to this, just to kind of endorse Dr. Rowling's primer for a couple different reasons. So the first question that I kind of pose rhetorically is, what is the merit to arts-based research to those who don't consider themselves artists? Mm-hmm. So if this is a research paradigm, you know, and we articulate a nomenclature mm-hmm. or terms mm-hmm. that we could use mm-hmm. to really kind of outline mm-hmm. how artists tend to work. Mm-hmm. And first it serves to demystify. The other ironic thing is many of us, probably even in this room, you're kind of determined to be an artist, you know, when you're 5 years old. She makes good pictures. She's an artist. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, you don't really have a choice in the matter, but we don't see a kid who's, you know, kind of as Piaget would say, you know, a kid who throws his or her peas from a high chair and makes some discoveries about gravity. Mm-hmm. She's a wonderful physicist, mm-hmm. right? It's not something that we do because physics are concrete in such a way that that we respect a certain hierarchy in physics as it pertains to the larger society, where I think that because of the mystique of the artist, the fetish of the artist, mm-hmm. and how easily we as a society bestow that title on people, there are people who are intimidated. Mm-hmm. You know, what can I do to arts, you know, in arts-based research? I'm not good at drawing, but I think that as we saw yesterday and how the methodology is articulated, we can see relationships to other ways of knowing without feeling like we have to have these tremendous skills and knowledge of the anatomical figure mm-hmm. that has been kind of defined as the academic route to being an artist mm-hmm. As it pertains to our ability to render and master certain techniques. Mm-hmm. So I think that it serves many, many roles as it pertains to our education and also research methods. Yep. Mm-hmm. What is the position of the marginal to this form of methodology? And something that I keep going, James and Dr. Rowling, Dr. James Rowling mentioned earlier in the interview, is he talked about his particular dissertation and how, you know, the notion of repositioning, you know, and interestingly, as an African-American male in a predominantly white institution with a predominantly white dissertation committee, there were questions that I was asking that were so far off the radar because they were specific to identity. They were specific to underrepresented groups, and they were specific to marginalized content. Mm-hmm. So if you're asking questions about content that is not part of the prevalent discourse, you know, then there's a need for repositioning. And that repositioning may call on other kinds of instruments to assist one in constructing a new methodology for addressing the content that is not prevalently addressed in the academic discourse of that field. So, question again, what is the relationship to self? What is the relationship to marginalized content? And also, what is the relationship or comparison between a truth and a discovery? It doesn't have to be a truth to be a discovery. Mm-hmm.
Were you talking about your dissertation or his?
Well, I was actually talking about both of them. Mm-hmm. Because in Dr. Rowling's case, if I can kind of give my take, if you will, mm-hmm. is that there was a list of questions or things that were emerging, and the question of how to handle these mm-hmm. became as critical to the dissertation as anything. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are some forms of content or data that are addressed in a very conventional way because there are models to handle certain kinds of data. But what about when we have data that there is no charted way of addressing them? And I think that's the impetus for this book. So again, and so in my case, I had that dilemma. I didn't have a Graham Sullivan or a James Rowling to advocate for any other kinds of instruments or methodologies. But it was, so it was kind of a halt. So okay, well I'm addressing data that is unfamiliar to everyone here other than me. Mm-hmm. And you know, where I think in a traditional or conventional circumstance, you have data that fits in certain kind of paradigms. And so, okay, well that sounds like an ethnography, or that sounds like an archival research project, mm-hmm. or this is the way that this is a good conceptual framework, and because it relates very well to other forms and other structures. Mm-hmm. You know, I think his first thought was maybe this is post-structural, mm-hmm. right, which is an obvious start, mm-hmm. when you know it's not measuring up to these conventions. Mm-hmm. So in my case, I was confronted with difference, with marginalized content, with data that only myself or few people could be the authority of, if there was an authority. So the people of my particular committee, you know, wait a minute, this can't be academia if I don't know all about it, right?
So I can answer that question this way. At Syracuse University, we're in the process of revising our current program plan, the program plans for art education that we inherited, and officially revising them. And we're in the middle of adding courses, a course in arts-based research, and a course in narrative inquiry, or narrative research processes, are used, and their textbooks written on how to use narrative in arts-based contexts and in social science contexts, right? So I've been running the narrative course for about 3 summers now, and I'm about to regularize it so that I can offer it in the fall and spring. In that course, I have had a variety of kinds of students. Students who are very, very steeped in the social sciences, and students who are more curious about something that was unknown to them, something that they were not taught or was not never introduced to them by their professors. And I've had an array of reactions. I've had students who took to it like a man coming out of the desert, right? This is what I've always needed. This is the water, you know, and finding water, you know. This is what I needed. This, you know, and I've had students who have come out of a very strict social science background, and one student in particular comes to mind who began experimenting with poetry, began experimenting with visual and graphic portrayals of interviews, right, where he drew. I was working with someone who could help draw a graphic novel type of portrayal of these interviews to use for professional development, to use for presenting at research conferences, and just entirely took, and is getting ready to publish an article in this, using visual means, right? And it was totally new to him. I've had students who got angry that I was telling them how that there are other ways of approaching and looking at research, and I've had slammed doors, you know. But I've had those same students come back and work at it from where they are, right, and find a median where they could bridge their current knowledge about research and this new knowledge about research and find a pathway that was productive for them. So I've never had a student who was so resistant to it that they said, no, I'm not going to do it. Every student I've ever had has found some way to embrace certain concepts, certain of these concepts. So I've had a variety, and I've had to be very patient with students in the sense that I know that the power of the what I call the myth of objectivity, because everyone has biases. Our biases inform our experience, inform what we feel to be important, what we attracted to as research, what we're attracted to as methodologies. And I often say that arts-based researchers are comfortable with their reflexivity, their identity, their biases, and know how to negotiate them, know how to lay them out, see them, negotiate them, figure out how to, in spite of that or in concert with who they are as a researcher, come up with a valid construct that will develop a theory that can be used going forward by themselves or by someone else. So these classes can be a real place of negotiation.
It brings to mind, I've had a fair amount of recent success in my writing endeavors over the last few years, and it really started directly after I interviewed for the job at Syracuse University. And in the airport, I began to write. And it was because following my discussions with art education students at Syracuse and with Dr. Rowling, it really ignited something in me. And what it ignited was that, well, for one, methodologies and ways of pursuing and contextualizing information have not been exhausted. Mm-hmm. And it freed me up in a certain way, because I felt myself spinning, which is, you know, obviously it's important to ground our research in existing theory, mm-hmm. and finding affinities with mm-hmm. other scholars. Mm-hmm. And that's an important part of what we do.
Yeah.
But there are scholars, as in the case of, as I talked about, you know, certain aspects of our studies could be marginalized. So there are people out there with voices that are not as easy to find. Mm-hmm. So it may not be, you know, I'll just cite Foucault, or I'll cite Piaget. So there are these people who are more commonly serve as structures or framing for ideas. But do we need to create a space for fillers, for creating fillers, for finding others? Mm-hmm. And I think that's what that art space, research space is about. Mm-hmm. In my own case, it wasn't initially what one would consider arts-based research. It was in part narrative, mm-hmm. but it started with me. Mm-hmm. And as I said, there's a concurrent narrative running. You know, in the case of the mad scientist, where there is my perceivably objective pursuit in the lab, but there's that which is driving me mad as I respond to my findings or lack thereof. And what is the relationship between the space between these concurrent narratives, and what is the space that's created when the mad scientist, you know, uses himself or herself as the experiment, mm-hmm. and indulges in the potion. Mm-hmm. So those metaphors, I think, are really pertinent as it pertains to our position, our complex identities, as it relates to our discoveries and our pursuits.
Okay, so let me back up a little bit. This is the book that you're talking about, and I'll show it for the camera. It's called Cinderella Story, and it you can say the full title is Cinderella Story, a scholarly sketchbook about race, identity, Barack Obama, the human spirit, and other stuff that matters. And something I published in 2010 by Altamira Press, and it's part of a series called Crossroads in Qualitative Inquiry. And I want to read you something that explains, and then I'll say a little something about it. And this image is one of my works of art is illustrative of what the text is about. So it starts off with the fable of the Cinderella story. And one of the advertising, I'm gonna read this, right? One of the advertising blurbs or sentences that to help explain what the book is about, who it's for, says, Cinderella story argues that a post-structural and unexpected identity can be created from the charred embers of self-imagery strewn about an ash heap of stereotypes. Reinterpreted atop a pyre of modern identity constructs, authoritative stories, and assigned names. And consequentially, a Cinderella ending is not the end of a story, rather it is the inauguration of a new ever after, and which is why the book is titled as it is. Because ultimately, it's a book about identity, going back to Professor Matuk's original question. But it's about the transformation of identity, essentially. And it's about the fact that stereotypes are oversimplified fictions about human beings, and the social identity of the African American in America is one that is actually a story of reinterpretation of a lot of injurious social constructs that created stigma, created pain, created injury to both individuals and to a people group within the nation. But that, I'll say that it's a work of art-based research that actually stemmed and grew out of my dissertation. It was one of the qualifying papers that I wrote and as I was preparing for that research, which grew, was the germ that grew into this book. And it is a way of looking at the transformation of identity over time, over a period of time, as evidence in the visual culture of the United States, from where African Americans were portrayed as monsters, as ugly, as dangerous, as fools, as inept, as unable, as less than, and how in the midst of that, African Americans were a part of the, participated in their own agency in changing and turning around those identity constructs into portrayals or depictions of who they really were in the world, right? And what they were living as in the world, even albeit in a world that was presenting them as cartoons and as stereotypes, and how performances of identity, and by performances can be everyday lives lived, it could be plays, works of art, music, dance, performances of identity that are reinserted back into the visual culture that transform the story, that unnames the story. So the story names you as ugly, and then black is beautiful. How does that happen? How does that get negotiated within a culture that is attempting to hold to and maintain the norm, which is that this category of human beings is not as important or less than? So the book in itself is for, and I would say this as a last thing, is that it's not just a book for African Americans. It's a book for anyone who's marginalized, anyone who is marginalized through racism, sexism, classism, who is looking for a tale, an evidence of how individuals and a group decoded their stories of stigma and ugliness and recoded them into stories of truth, life, beauty, strength, possibility, and put it back into the culture so that it lives there as well. So now you have multiple stories that exist, and now you have coming across them, you have to negotiate them, right? You can't just take and assume that the stereotype is correct because you've got another story that's living right next to it, right? That says something else. So. And that's what the book is. And the book includes poetry, prose, my own images, found images from the visual culture, all overlapped in a multi-genre form of writing, so that its narrative is, and it draws upon my narrative practices. I consider myself, I said before, I consider myself an artist first, Well, I was writing poetry since I was a teenager. And so writing in a creative format is something that I consider part of my, one of my artistic practices, as well as being a mixed media artist. So so that's where it's generated, that's what it comes from, and that's what I hope it continues to be as other people encounter it.
There are a couple of metaphors that I want to kind of articulate as they pertain to James's book, which I read, and also getting back to the James Rowland quote about interpsychological detritus and cultural debris. So as it pertains to arts-based research, as I understand it and as it works for me, imagine the malleable material of debris and reconstituting that material and getting an approximation of something. So we have the, let's just say, for example, the oak tree, and the leaves fall, and the leaves collect, and the leaves break down, and the leaves connect to rubbish and many other things. And we get an approximation of something that we could analyze. Mm-hmm. But compare that approximation maybe to the metaphor of the frozen caveman, which is, you know, another kind of approximation of identity that is uncovered in a very different way. So it's intact. We thaw it out, we make observations. And, you know, James mentioned these twin peaks of scientific research versus arts-based research, where we have these two very different ways of uncovering and approximating self. Mm-hmm. So we can certainly, you know, devise theories and notions from this approximation that we collect through the debris and the detritus. But then we have this other frozen caveman metaphor that is in many regards intact, but separated significantly through time and space. So I think that as it pertains to practices, what James is saying about identity being broken and reclaimed and reconstituted and represented, it is in some way sifting and building and reclaiming that debris, as I understand it.
Yeah, and thanks for that that assessment, because I want to use your word approximation, because I talk a lot about arts-based research as a method of theory building. And one of the things that I point to as a common ground between the sciences and the arts is that both are in the process of building approximations, right? A theory essentially is an approximation of what is considered to be for the sciences, a truth claim about this is the way this works, and you build a model. That's an approximation of it. It's an approximation because it's as certain as it can get at that time. And then typically what will happen is that someone else will come along and build upon that theory and maybe retune it or refine it and get it even more close to what supposedly reality is. And it's presented in a certain model, you know, typically statistical and mathematical, but even in Dr. Bey's description, you understand that artists are also in the process of building approximations, right? And those approximations can be of phenomena in the world or relationships in the world, or it can be of intuitive, imagined worlds, right? But they're approximations that are constructive. And I talk about theory building as representative constructions or reconstructions or approximations, right, of things that of whatever it is that we are reconstituting in this art studio or in the scientific lab, right? And that's a place where there's common ground between what we do, but once again, it goes towards the idea that science is one way to get towards these approximations. The arts are another way of getting towards these approximations, and allows you to arrive at different kinds of approximations. Right? So that's a good thing to build upon. Contemporary artists, and this is something I'll be speaking about tomorrow, I think they do use arts-based research methodologies. But the language and the vocabulary of research is very much rooted in scientific, so they may not know or think of themselves as researchers, because the assumption based on the general nomenclature is that if you're a scientist, you're a researcher. But if you're not a scientist, then you're not doing something else, right? But as I've said before, I think that we're all familiar with the fact that not all artists are intending to do research, and some artists certainly do require research in order to create their concepts or their products. And we do know that there are artists whose work has become the catalyst for other people's research, right? Part of my goal is to, in writing this text, because it is not available yet, is to begin generating dialogue by which we can call and name methodologies that have yet to be named, right? And have an opportunity to talk about what it is that artists do in the studios and how it relates to what artists do who consider themselves teachers and what artists do who consider themselves to be researchers, and find out what we have in common. Because it's similar to creating boundaries that really don't need to be there, right? Ultimately, the reason why human beings create new knowledge is because they have curiosity, they have a question, they have something that's driving them. The drive can be about a very big question that has to do with something that is a question that's important to all of humanity or just society, or it might be a question that's a small question that has to do with something that is bugging them in the studio. What my mentor used to call a quizzical itch, you know. It can be, there are many different reasons, big questions and small questions, why someone embarks on an endeavor to know something better or understand something better. Some phenomena, some material, some relationship, some social structure. To some extent, I would argue that all artists are engaging in research, big R, small R. My effort is to begin to name some of those strategies and some of those methodologies, and then, but not so as to box them up and say this is this and this is only this. I'm sure there will be lots of overlaps between strategies, lots of overlaps between motivations, and the more messy, the more real it is, because life is messy, right? So,
the question, as I understood it, is which artists use arts-based research? And I think because this is a paradigm that's being articulated by certainly an artist, but not within the discourse of fine art. Mm-hmm. And as I mentioned yesterday, as it pertains to the market and the distribution of art, mm-hmm. you know, part of it, the enchantment mm-hmm. of art and the fetish of artists has a lot to do with that discourse. So I guess an appropriate question could be, which artists work methodologically? Mm-hmm. So which artists do we see who work in such a way that we may be able to, and I think Dr. Rowling kind of shared some of that in his lecture yesterday, but which artists work methodologically? And we can kind of chart and obviously artists have a variety of different ways of working, yeah. but which artists work in such a way that where we can see evidence of certain behaviors mm-hmm, mm-hmm. that are associated with certain kinds of knowledge acquisition? So in the case, you know, I'm thinking about like Bloom's taxonomy and looking at certain behavioral verbs. The first artist is probably one of the most obvious suspects is Marc Dion. Mm-hmm. So we think about the work of Marc Dion, who's drawing on history, but also drawing on anthropological methods for contextualizing, for charting, for labeling various forms of data in his quest. So there's an overt methodology that's related to the sciences, it's related to archaeology, but also related to anthropology. Mm-hmm. So, you know, but for that matter, maybe Joseph Cornell's work. You know, there's again, a contextualization of objects, mm-hmm. A juxtaposition of objects. So we can kind of, but there are some artists we can't see what they're doing. We mm-hmm. can't see in their mind. and they're not willing to let us in their mind. Mm-hmm. And they can be very reclusive, they can be very cynical. Mm-hmm. And that's an extension of that persona. This is what I made. I don't have any obligation to you. I don't have any obligation to museum. I don't have any obligation to education, to students. This is what I do. And we can only see the object from that point. So I think as we move away from modernism, mm-hmm. which is historically about someone else's notion of a truth, mm-hmm. That was, you know, it represents itself, whatever that means.
Essentialism.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we're moving into a post-structuralist era, something else is happening, and there are some people who are, let's say, more apt to share their cards mm-hmm. than others, you know. So maybe we could even say that modernists held their cards very close to their chests, mm-hmm. and that became a part of the discourse of modernism, mm-hmm. you know. And now we're in a postmodern society where the identity of the artist can be, doesn't have to be, but can be intrinsically related to the process or the product. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I think that it's kind of you can superimpose the theory on artists to make sense of them, those who are chartable in that way. But I think there are many artists who would admit to having a methodology. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I think Mark Dion is probably the one that comes to mind, like, first. Do you know Mark Dion's work? He's the artist who kind of comes to mind first and foremost. And I think even the later work of Chris Burton, who's another artist who's been a trendsetter from going back to the 70s, but clearly now his work is definitely connected to engineering and science and physics in a very different way.
This is not to add to this. To what Dr. Bey was saying, but just to say that when I talk tomorrow about contemporary arts as it relates to arts-based methodologies, I'll be naming at least 24 artists who work methodologically and talk about that to some extent. But building on what Dr. Bey was saying, there are more artists than the ones I will name. And there are more methodologies than the ones I will name. And the key, once again, hopefully, is to generate conversation about those methodologies and that allow us to illuminate the arts as a strategy for building theories, building knowledge about the world, and disseminating that knowledge. Right?
The most obvious suspect is Da Vinci. So, you know, we think about what we can gather from Da Vinci's mind by seeing that he was certainly theorizing mm-hmm. about mechanisms mm-hmm. that were well beyond his time, you know, through arts-based inquiries. So I don't know that that's always a part of the conversation, but I think there's something about the way that he worked, you know, whether it's through his sketches or his sketchbook, that evidenced a methodological process of thinking. And so that's just, you know, and I think it could be argued that Da Vinci was a scientist, mm-hmm. you know, a scientist who can draw very well, mm-hmm. right?
First of all, it's a very good question. And actually, my talk has been almost entirely from the arts side of the coin, even though in doing the research I found that there are journals and articles that are written by scientists who are also artists, names I don't have at the ready at the moment, but who talked very specifically about how the studio and the arts, their practices as an artist, have informed their ability to see their scientific models. A very unusual suspect, since Sharif was talking about usual, very easy to identify suspect in terms of Da Vinci. I would say that I was surprised to read that Albert Einstein had studied music throughout his youth and spoke about how his framework as a musician helped him to see mathematically and scientifically, and how it informed. It's a different kind of practice. It's not visual. But as I've pointed out, I'm not just talking about the visual arts practices. I'm talking about the arts practices in total, right? Which cut across dance, theater, performance. So that is a question that's worth pursuing. That's a question that's worth another article or another book, right? In terms of scientists. But I think part of the argument for me has been to first just make it to establish some sort of baseline understanding, which is that when we are talking about research, we are talking about several different species. And in this case, I'm talking about the species that is based on arts practices. All right. Establish that first so that we can understand that there's different nomenclature that exists if you're building upon these practices and these methodologies. Begin to talk about some of these, and then hopefully it begins to breed some conversations across borders. And ultimately, it would be wonderful for me to see scientists and artists talking together about models of knowledge creation or theory building that involve complex models that are not just mathematical or statistical, but also visual and or narrative, you know, and we don't know what that, I don't know what that will look like, but I would love to see those conversations take place.
And I guess kind of piggybacking on that again, there's reconstruct, deconstruct. Mm-hmm. So I think that a lot of times when we think about it, again, getting back to this metaphor of the frozen caveman versus the debris, you know, so reconstructing to deconstruct is a very different process than to just look at something as is and looking at it evaluatively, and you know, and that we're taking away. So discovery means in many people's eyes, you know, that you're dusting off and clarifying something, you know, that is from the ruins, mm-hmm. as opposed to interpreting that object in a different way, mm-hmm. and then dusting it off, mm-hmm. and then comparing it to what you actually discover. Mm-hmm. So I think again, as a process, there is a different way of framing how those ideas come to fruition. Mm-hmm. I mean, scientists discover tools and then learn to use them. Mm-hmm. And we don't say, I don't know how to use that. I could never pick up that tool. But that happens all the time because the arts can be a very isolated and esoteric field. Mm-hmm. You know, even more so than the sciences. We're not afraid of picking up calculators and scales, but those are scientific tools that are used by everyone. Mm-hmm. And hopefully, you know, this discourse will continue to break down some of those perceived barriers. Mm-hmm. And yes, this tool is for everybody, and yes, this tool is as generative as a calculator or a balanced scale. Mm-hmm.
Beyond what I've just said, well, you know, I hope this is the start of the opportunity to archive visually and digitally these responses. I think is sort of important because, as Dr. Bey was mentioning, some of our discourse yields discourse, right? And so that us beginning to talk about this, and then it gets presented to in some other venue, conversations will begin. Hopefully, we'll be able to use this to reflect a little bit on further in terms of what we were thinking, what we're presenting, because you know it's meant to continue to develop and grow, right? In terms of the conversation. So I hope we'll continue to have more conversations across the borders between the United States and Brazil and across the disciplinary borders and continue this into the disciplinary conversation. And once again, thank you for the opportunity.